Good evening, folks. I know some of you, but I don't think I know all of you, so allow me to sort of introduce myself. My name is Alastair, Logan. I've been coming here to Gerrard Street since I was about 8 years old, and I'm a lot older than that now. I am father to two children, husband to one wife. It's important that we get that distinction right. I help lead the Sunday school or lighthouse through the house, when I'm not here doing the Sunday school, I'm a lecturer at RGU. For those of you that go to Aberdeen Uni, that's the university you go to if you want to get a job once you graduate. No? Okay, sorry. Too soon. Okay. So you know. Yeah. Okay, so aside from that, I'm making bad jokes and jokes about your future career. I've got one. What else about me? Well, trust me, this bit is actually relevant. I'm a big fan of football. Soccer, football, God's game, the beautiful game, as it's sometimes called, is my thing. It's the thing that makes me happy on a Saturday if my teams win. Teams plural. I support Aberdeen Football Club. They're like who I've committed to for my whole life. And then I have a team down in England. They're called Chelsea Football Club. They've never been the most popular team to support. And right now, even I question my own values and ethics around that one. So why do I raise that? As a football fan. And football fans are all the same. They're all the same in their fickleness. Okay? It doesn't matter which team you support, but if you ever go onto any sort of football fan forum or chat and you start seeing them talking about their team, they're normally moaning, they're normally grumbling about something, about the current state of the squad, the current state of their manager, or the current state of the teams above them or just below them. They are fickle. And they're fickle because at some point or another, if you follow a football fan chat, you'll see them start hankering after the past, the glory days. Now, being an Aberdeen Football Club fan, we had glory days. We had glory days in the 1980s, okay? When Alex Ferguson was our manager. And those were glory days. We were the best team in Scotland, probably one of the best teams in Britain, one of the best teams in Europe. We were outstanding. We are less than that now. But every time you go on to it, you look back into the past. Now, I bet if football fan forums were available in the 1980s and you went on the football fan chats when Aberdeen were at the top of the league and beating everyone left, right and centre, there would probably be some fans who were hankering after the past of the 1970s or the 1960s because the game was probably a bit purer and a little bit better. Football fans are fickle. Well, in today's passage, we see the fickleness of the people of Israel. Okay, there's a whole lot of fickleness, or rather, a whole lot of grumbling. Okay, in fact, the word grumble comes up 10 times in our passage today. Now, we started in Exodus 15, verse 7, I think it was, or 13, sorry.
No, 22.
Tell a lie. Is it
22,
thank you. Just prior to that, we've got Exodus 15, 1-21. It's Moses' song. And Moses has written a song, whether he wrote it or one of his pals wrote it, nonetheless. It's a song that is celebrating who God is. It's saying how awesome he is, how he has delivered them from the Egyptians. Said, "You have led us in your steadfast love, the people you redeemed. You have guided them by your strength to your holy abode. We are God's people and God is our God. And ain't he great and aren't we great and everything wonderful." 3 days later, they start to grumble because they ain't found no water yet. 3 days they go from everything was perfect. God is the best. And we have just been released from centuries of oppression. We have just been saved from Egypt through 10 plagues, through 10 miracles imposed on them, and none of them have touched us. We've been saved through the Red Sea, where we passed through the Red Sea. not a drop of water falls on us, and yet when the Egyptians come after us, it envelops them, and that they are drowned before our eyes. God has appeared before us and led us through up to the Red Sea as a pillar, a cloud of smoke and a cloud of fire. God is clearly with them, right? You're not going to forget that in a hurry. But 3 days later, they do. 3 days later, they start to grumble and they get nostalgic for the good old days. The good old days in Egypt where, do you remember where we had meat to eat and food to eat and water to drink? Never mind the fact that they put our firstborn to death. Never mind the fact that, you know, they enslaved us, that they made it more difficult for us. Never mind that. Just remember the good old days. So, there's a whole lot of grumbling, but I want to break down this passage that we've looked at today into three sort of component parts, because there's a lot of testing going on. And the first one is where we have the bitter water made sweet, where God tests to see if they will listen. Exodus 15, 25, 26 says, "The Lord made for them a statute and a rule, and there he tested them, saying, 'If you will diligently listen to the voice of the Lord your God, and do that which is right in his eyes, and give ears to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of the diseases on you that I put on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord your healer.'" Now, they weren't a difficult set of statutes to follow at that point. They didn't have the Ten Commandments. They didn't have the Book of the Law. So basically, follow these simple instructions and you're golden. Everything is great. Second part, we have the manna and the quail. God tests to see if they will obey him. 16:4, verse 4. "Then the Lord says to Moses, 'Behold, I am about to rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a day's portion every day, that I may test them, whether they will walk in my law or not.'" And then 3, water from the rock. The people test Yahweh. The people test God. Previously, God was testing them. The Israelites get so uppity that they think, a month now into the desert, and after more miracles, okay? First, we want water. He gives them water. We want food to eat. Well, he gives them manna, and then he gives them... Well, we want meat as well, so he gives them meat to eat as well. He gives them quail. That's still not enough for them. And he called the name of the place Massa and Meribah because of the quarrelling of the people of Israel and because they tested the Lord by saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" It would be comedic if it weren't so tragic that a people who... I don't know about you, I've not seen miracles like that happen. I think if I'd seen one of the plagues of Egypt occur in the way that it did, in the way that it was prophesied as well, well, I say I would then trust the Lord. I would know that God is with me. And yet, when we read through this, it's dead easy to get so judgmental on the Israelites. And yet, as we're reading this, the Israelites are us. We are the Israelites in this story. It's dead easy to get on our high horse and think, I would do it different. I would do it better. Through a little examination within my own life, I know that's not true. I know I would have probably been like the rest of the Israelites. I certainly would have been like Moses. In spite of all this, God's provision, and this is the title of the talk Tim gave me, is God Provides. God's provision is so specific and so on the money. It's not too much. It's not too little. And yet, what a heck of a response that we get from the people of Israel. So, I remember reading this the first time, or a week ago. Not for the first time, but the first time in preparation. And testing. I'm a lecturer. It's my job to test people, right? I'm not going to lie to you, I'm going to let you into a little secret about lecturers. We kind of like testing students. There's a little bit of Schadenfreude within us that we kind of get off on seeing the discomfort of students.
Yeah.
Struggle and wrestle with what they're doing. And for the pure purposes of just because we had to do it, so you've got to do it. And believe me, it's much easier on this side of the laptop than it is on the other side. Okay, when we're doing the lecture. We also test for a number of other reasons as well, not just because it's fun to see people squirm, okay? And if you don't believe me, try being a lecturer. It's really cool. But rather, we test people to see their mental. We see what state they're in. We see, actually, have they been paying attention to the lectures that, I'd love to say that we sweat over. We do sweat over. But have they been paying attention to the lectures and the guidance and the seminars that we've been delivering? And see where we get a bit of a God conflict, can't we? But this is the whole point that God tests the people of Israel. Actually, on their way out of Egypt, he could have taken them through the land where the Philistines lived. But he says, actually, no, that will bring about strife and conflict and war. They're not ready for that just yet. They're not ready. That will put them off. They'll lose heart and they'll want to turn back to Egypt. So he takes them into the wilderness deliberately. And yet, God tests them basically to see, well, they've written that song of Moses, but do they really buy it? Do they really believe it? I don't know if you've heard the phrase, what's it? Christians don't tell lies, they sing them. Because, this is no offence to the worship. But if you think of some of the words that we sing, and I think some of the words that I sang there, how true is that? If actually God took an inventory and says, okay, then, let's see how, you know, do you stand on my promises all the time, Alastair? You know, 40% is a pass, right? So 60% of the time you don't. And 40% is a pass at RGU, anyway.
Is that
not for placements? Yeah, not for placements. Oh, that's just passed them. Anyway, so. You know, you've written this wonderful song. Let's see where you're truly at. Let's see where you're at with me right now. We see very quickly, within 72 hours, of actually where the Israelites are in their relationship with God. You see very quickly how much actually they are so focused on the here and the now, in spite of the fact that 10 plagues have swarmed over Egypt, in spite of the fact that they've come through the Red Sea. Instead of turning to God and saying, God, I don't know what's happening here, but a little help. We remember how faithful you've been already when we cried out to you when we were in Egypt. Now they grumble. They hanker over the old times. They want to go back, and eventually they're that close to stoning Moses. They're that close to stoning Moses and just heading back to Egypt. I don't know how they would have been received, bearing in mind that the Egyptian army had been drowned. I can't imagine they'd have been received particularly well. And I'm assuming they would have known that, but they were thinking that's better than what's going ahead. In spite of the Israelites' response, what does God do? He gives them water, he gives them manna, he gives them quail, he gives them an oasis in the desert. He gives them just enough to eat and drink so they don't have too much, but not too little. He gives them enough that they even get a rest day as well. God provides. God provided for their daily needs, no more, no less. God provided for their rest days so they could get twice as much on the Sabbath, or twice as much for the Sabbath so they didn't even have to work. And God provided for their future needs. As far as he says, later on, he said, put it in a jar and keep it, almost as a reminder, as a totem to my faithfulness towards you. Later on, as you read through Joshua, when they go and start actually taking the land of Canaan, every time they win a battle, they build a little cairn of stones or an altar. And the purpose of it is so that in generations to come, every time their children walk past that altar, that cairn, it's to remind them of how faithful God was. And folks, I'll probably come back to this a wee bit later, but I would strongly encourage you to start doing that in your own lives. If depending on how long or how deep your relationship with God is, I'm sure after a specific point of time, there are times when you look back on where God has come through for you, where you can look and think, nah, that wasn't because of me, that wasn't because of good planning on my part, or just a bit of grit and determination or hobbies. God came through for me. Build a totem in your mind to that. Build a cairn, build a little altar in your mind to remind yourself of that. Because trial and tribulation, for as long as you walk with Jesus, trial and tribulation will come and will continue to come. It's a promise. But let's go back to the Israelites. In spite of his provision, they still don't fully trust him. Oh, you know what? I see we've got this manna on the ground, but he might not provide for us tomorrow, so go and just go and get a little bit extra. Go and just get a little bit extra for us. Now, God sees that coming. I mean, God tests them. God already knows, but there's another thing, reason behind this testing, because God knows how faithful they are already for even testing. But through the testing of the Israelites, it's showing them that this is who I am. I am a God who provides and shows mercy and patience, and this is where you are. You're not there. He gives them the law. He gives them the Ten Commandments. And in part, yes, this is a covenant. You live this way, I'll be your God, I'll look after you, I'll protect you. And yet it also shows them exactly who God is and exactly who they are, because by the end of the book of Exodus, they will have broken every single one of those laws. They will see exactly not just their relationship with God, but who they are in relation. Here and we are here. But God sort of tests them, do you really trust me? It's easy to worship God when the going is good, but the temptation is that when the going is good, we start to think that it's by our own hard work, it's our own graft, it's our own intellect. It's not through God's provision. We think that we are in control, and yet we only need to look at the last 2 years in COVID to know that we are really not in control. We are so not in control. We're fickle. We're lacking in faith. We grumble. We're lacking in humility. And we are entitled. It's not a great way to endear myself to say that. I say this to you, but I'm saying this as much to myself as well. Towards the end, they think it's okay to test God. They are getting close to Pharaoh-like behavior. Moses came along and says, if you don't free my people, I'm going to send this plague. And go ahead, God, do your worst. God did it. Pharaoh kept on doing it. You can take the people out of Egypt, but they're struggling to take Egypt out of the people. They're trying. They're thinking of stoning Moses now. God in his righteousness would have been within his right to wipe them out. And in the coming weeks you will see that there is severe consequences for their behaviour, that they would not enter into the promised land. But he still doesn't. And yet, later on in the Psalms, Psalm 95, 10 to 11, we get to read God's mind with regards to what he felt towards that generation. For 40 years I loathed that generation. And said, they are a people who go astray in their heart, and they have not known my ways. Therefore I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. As a result of their behavior, that we're starting to see now, they're not getting into the promised land. In fact, this generation don't get to enter into the promised land at all. It's the next generation. And yet, in spite of God's wrath, in spite of his loathing, and I really don't think we should underestimate that, if God loathes you, man, we're in trouble. But he still provided. So, how does God provide for us now? Well, how often do we grumble when things don't go our way? When God doesn't answer our prayer, the way we want him to, or doesn't appear to answer it at all when our prayers are bouncing off the ceiling, when God doesn't give us what we think we actually deserve. Well, Christian, what do we deserve? Our focus is so short-sighted, and insofar as that we don't recognise that God, what God has provided for us, yet he has given us everything in Christ Jesus. Christ is our bread of life, or our manna. And the bread of life, whoever comes to me will never ever hunger. Christ is the rock from which the water flows. Paul explains that all ate the same spiritual food and all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ. This is a foretelling of what's happening in the desert, that actually this is what Christ eventually becomes for us. God has given us everything we will ever need. I am sinful, God has shown me mercy. I am patient, God has shown me patience. I am unfaithful, God is faithful. I was heading towards hell, he gave me Jesus. God provides through all. At this point, I think it's really important to say, because I really enjoy doing apologetics. Apologetics is my, if you don't know apologetics, it's giving a defence, a reasonable defence of the faith. And so, when I'm not watching football on YouTube, when I should be working, I'm often listening to apologetics and debates online and everything. One of the common things that maybe people more sympathetic to the Christian faith might say is, yeah, your God of the Old Testament, he's so judgmental, but your God of the New Testament, I can get on board with that. He shows mercy. But just read through Exodus. God shows mercy when we have no right to expect it. God is a merciful God. Yes, there is judgment in the Old Testament. There's judgment in the New Testament as well. But God is a God of mercy. Now, the one thing I kind of want to leave us with, because it can end on a bit of a bum note, thinking, well, okay, it's not okay to grumble. And yet, Christ has promised us that if we are going to be his disciples, we can expect trial and tribulation and testing. And if you're like me and a bit of a wimp and a bit soft, I can't say I particularly look forward to trial and tribulation and testing. And so, I knew, because Exodus, I remember watching the Ten Commandments with Charlton Heston when I was about 7 years old, and trust me, that film is about as long as 4 years. It's really long, it's an epic. But I knew very quickly that grumbling was not right, grumbling's not okay. Well, what am I supposed to do when I reach trial and tribulation? What am I supposed to do when I testing? Okay, well, grumbling's wrong. I know, I'll just keep stewing. I won't say a word. I'll say nothing. And God will see that because I'm not grumbling and because I'm saying nothing about it, God will see that and he'll take the testing away from me really quickly. Basically, what I'm thinking, I'm smarter than God. I can trick God and he'll be fooled by it. And no, God, trust me, God's not that dumb. God's not dumb at all, actually. What happens there is that God sees exactly what you're doing. In my case, he saw exactly what I was doing, to the point where it was almost like if I just hold my breath long enough underwater, God will eventually pull me up. And I'm just holding my breath. And God is like, I'm waiting for you to come up and speak to me. I'm waiting. And I just, and I go, any anxiety, any frustration, any anger that is bottled down, trust me, as a social worker and one who teaches psychology, that's not healthy. It ain't good for you. It ain't going to end well. You're going to either just run out of air and drown, metaphorically, or you're going to come out and burst and do yourself a lot of damage. God wants relationship with us, right? Actually, part of that time in the desert was to show the people that, you know what, guys, it's just me and you. And when it's just me and you, you ain't got nothing else to rely on but me. And through these 40 years, you are going to see that it's me that leads you through the hard times. It's me that leads you through into the promised land. It's not through your own might and strength and intelligence or their lack of. It's me that gets you through. So when we face hard times, God doesn't want us to grumble. But there is such a thing as lament. Okay, and there's a whole book in the Bible, Lamentations, where there is righteousness in bringing our difficulties and our struggles to God. And it's throughout the Psalms as well. There are worshipful Psalms, and yet there are Psalms where David says that his pillow is wet through his own weeping and tears. So rather than take on a position of grumbling and self-righteousness and entitlement, rather take on one of humbleness. And when I was younger, I was into my music. I really liked Radiohead. I still do. One of the most depressing bands you get out there. And so Psalm 88 really spoke to me, because towards the end of Psalm 88, Radiohead would struggle to write a dirge as dark as this. Towards the end it says, O Lord, I cry to you in the morning, my prayer comes before you. O Lord, why do you cast my soul away? Why do you hide your face from me? Afflicted and close to death from my youth up, I suffer your terrors, I am helpless. Your wrath is swept over me, your dreadful assaults destroy me. They surround me like a flood all day long, they close in on me together. You have caused my beloved and my friend to shun me. My companions have become darkness. Eat that, Antonio. That's where the psalm ends. My only friend now is the darkness. I have nothing else. But Psalm 89, immediately the same author begins with, I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever with my mouth. I will make known your faithfulness to all generations. For I said, steadfast love will be built up forever. In the heavens, you will establish your faithfulness. In the darkest of darkest nights of the soul, the psalmist responds, not with grumbling. I will take Psalm 8 at face value. I'm not going to take that as some poetic license. I'm going to take it as read that his beloved and his friends don't want to know this guy. All he's got is the darkness, and yet his response is what's often described as a sacrifice of praise. That in spite of these hard times, where the devil would have me grumble, where the devil would have me grumble and turn my back on God and thumb my nose at him and give him, stick two fingers up at him and say, you've abandoned me, you have forsaken me. And that's what Christ said on the cross. There's righteousness. But he turns it around, says, I will offer a sacrifice of praise. I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever. We can turn in our humbleness towards God, and God will hear us. Now, I don't want to say and be so basic, think that almost as a means of, well, if I turn to God in humbleness, then he will take away my strife and my struggle, my strife and trouble. Sometimes that will happen. Sometimes that will happen. But sometimes it won't. We've got the example of Paul, who has a thorn in his side, a thorn in his flesh, where he said, I've asked countless times for God to take this away from me. And yet God's response is, my grace is enough. That might happen in some of the strife and trouble that you're maybe experiencing right now, or that you might experience in the future. But his grace is enough. So the next time that you face trial or tribulation, or if you're feeling it right now, don't be like the Israelites. Don't grumble. Instead, present your worries and your problems to God humbly. Recall the times that he has come through for you in the past. Recall, build those totems in your mind, because God is faithful. And offer a sacrifice of worship. Be humble, because God has already provided for us in Christ.